Okay, so one thing to mention is I was asked about slides and materials and so on. So if you now click onto the web page from the school, you get a link here to the slides, and that gets you to a wiki page, which is this one here. And because I'm a bit paranoid about copyrights, especially future copyrights, you know, whoever wants to sue you in 10 years for a web page that you don't even know about, this is password protected to get you to the slides. So please take a note of the username temp.1 and the password in a funny written Mont Blanc here, Mont Blanc 18. And you will get there slides from the notes, and you will get there as well some things we will need, the GWING. I also put here the sensitivity data from the Einstein telescope and from the Cosmic Explorer, and I put a few more useful reading things here, one about quantum noise, a very comprehensive living review, which is for free, open access, the Einstein telescope design study and the Cosmic Explorer reference paper, and what we will come later to, I also put in here a link for a Google spreadsheet where I thought if we start in an hour or so with these kind of small working groups, that we get some overview who is doing what, that people can, you know, put in their teams the names and what they are doing, so if people don't have a team yet, that they can join one of the existing teams, okay, so that we just keep a little bit of track who is doing what. Good, with that, let's come back for another half hour or so to the 3G stuff. Okay, and we talked about the footprint here of ET, and we need to follow this up. Discussions at lunch made it clear that I didn't make very clear what is meant here by each of these red angle here, or these different colored interferometers. So each of these colored 60 degree opening angle interferometers has two. So each of these detectors has two interferometers in there, a low frequency one and a high frequency one. So in total, what you would have in the ET design is actually six interferometers, which many people find very scary to get them all. Ellen is laughing. we had some experience in LIGO with two interferometers, but they were cross-coupling, cross-talking, and we hope that we can get rid of part of this by having them separate vacuum systems, but still many people are very skeptical about this, to say the least. So how would then look a full ET observatory? So if we now put a little bit more detail and go from this one red detector here, this one red detector would look as follows. You would have here, and this is schematically drawn, one of these end caverns. You would have two interferometers in there, a high frequency interferometer, a low frequency interferometer. So that would be these two beams here. And then in addition, in order to get your frequency dependent squeezing, you would need to have these very long filter cavities to get the good sensitivity. So you would have another two to three beams going down in the arm for this interferometer. Okay, and this interferometer gives you more or less a signal and some information about the polarization, but not the full polarization. And then what you do next is to plug in a second detector, again consisting out of two interferometers, a low frequency and high frequency one, with additional filter cavities, and then you get the possibility to resolve your polarization. And then you put in a third one, the green, and that gives you all of the redundancy and null streams. Have null streams been mentioned before? Do people know what I mean when I talk about null streams? Okay, people shaking their head. So the problem with our gravitational wave detectors is that if you look at a single interferometer, because they are so sensitive, there's all kind of different noise sources which cause small glitches, small excess power in H of T. And it's very hard for you to distinguish, if you just look at the single interferometer, is that a real gravitational wave signal or just noise. At my time at GEO, we had about 2,000 triggers, burst triggers every day, and obviously these were not astrophysical events, but they were whatever, a train passing by, a thunderstorm somewhere, and so on. So a null stream gives you the idea of a null stream is, wouldn't it be nice to have a capability to somehow modify your data streams so that you would have a data or one output channel which is insensitive to gravitational waves? Okay, so you have one channel which gives you all of your gravitational waves, and then you have one channel derived from the same interferometer or interferometers which has per definition no gravitational wave in there. So now if you see your 2000 triggers and 1999 also show up in the null stream, then you know, oh, okay, these are not gravitational waves, but you could distinguish this one by actually seeing that this is not showing up in the null stream. It's not something which we would use for calling it a detection, but it would be a very good diagnostics tool. So that's what this null stream capability is, what people were very curious to have. Say again? No. In this case, it's just the linear combination of the three output signals. So because you see you have some information about the gravitational wave in the red one here, some in the blue one, some in the green one, and now depending on which linear combination you do, very similar to the time delay interferometry for LISA, which I'm pretty sure someone will mention later on, you can either find one which gives you the best gravitational wave signal and this gives one which is per definition free of gravitational waves. Okay? Yeah. Yeah. Yes.
Why wouldn't the low frequency one only be low frequency squeezing? In fact, you even said when you talked about it that you don't care about shadows.
Okay. So then we need to go back to the sensitivity of this. Okay. So you can make it a little bit simpler. That's correct. So for example, here we look at. So this is a high frequency detector, and this has now squeezing, and this is frequency dependent. If it wouldn't be frequency dependent squeezing, we have about a factor of 3 squeezing here, then you would get a factor of 3. So the normal shot noise or the normal quantum noise would lay actually at this curve here, and we now have frequency dependent squeezing to get it down here as well. If you would just do the high frequency, the phase squeezing, then actually this quantum noise curve would lie up here. Okay, so you would have lost, and in this region it still contributes to your sensitivity. Okay, so I agree, you don't need to do it super duper here, because somewhere here is your low frequency detector, but you need to do something to not damage it. Okay, and for that reason, actually for ET, we scaled down for the high frequency interferometer, and the filter cavities will only be 500 meters long there. Okay, and with the 500 meters, what will happen is that this curve will just come to the case where if you wouldn't have any squeezing at all at low frequencies. Okay, so that's for the high frequency one. For the low frequency one, this is a different story, because here, in order to get the optimal sensitivity, so we can do two things. So if you use tune signal recycling, you would still have at some point the flip from being limited by shot noise and the phase fluctuations to here at low frequencies being limited by the back action noise, the radiation pressure. So you would need to have one filter cavity to switch the phase of the squeezing from the high frequency to the low frequency. So one is minimum. Okay. In this particular case, we have chosen for the ET design study, currently uses a very complicated design which has detuned signal recycling in there. And because we have the detuned signal recycling, at the optical resonance you swap some of your signal from the phase quadrature to the amplitude quadrature, and in order to correct this and keep still the shot noise down, you need a filter cavity for this one, and then another one here where you go from the shot noise to the back action noise. Okay, that is not that, and again, that was something we talked about at lunch. This is not an ideal choice. You can get nearly the same sensitivity just with one filter cavity, but the reason why we put that one in is that we designed ET in 2010 as an infrastructure. It wasn't so much about the detector that we would actually build in there, but we wanted to have an infrastructure where we can, which is flexible enough so that we can put in detector generation 3, 4, 5, and so on. And if there's something we have learned from the first generation, then it is, you know, don't constrain your space where you can put tubes and tanks and so on. And that's why this solution here with this rather complicated signal recycling, for which you need the two filter cavities here is actually something that survived. But I agree, if it's really talking about money, then this is something we can do more accurately or in a more efficient way. And I put a plot in the ETD paper. There's actually a plot where I compare different single recycling configurations. So how does this look now if we make it from the sketchy drawing into something more fancy? So this is what the design actually would look like. You have a tunnel of the order 6-7 meters in diameter, and then you have all of these different tubes here, tubes for the high frequency and the low frequency detector of one color. Here you have the other arm of a different color, high frequency, low frequency detector, and then you have here some filter cavity tubes. So quite a busy tunnel. The whole thing, if you go for the very low frequencies and follow this proposal from Stefano Braccini and go for merely entirely passive seismic isolation, you would end up with the 17 meter high super attenuators, which are fairly big. You know, our whole infrastructure looks fairly biggish. I'm not sure this is really something that we will carry through the design. In the end, I think there must be a solution to build something more compact using initial active seismic isolation, what Peter showed us today. You just put onto your first stage a sensor, feed back as much as possible until you sit on the sensor noise of the sensor, and you would feed back that, so that limits how much gain you can put on there. And then in the end, after you had one or two stages of that, you do the passive seismic isolation. Okay, and this is more or less all I wanted to say about the ET design. Just to mention, it's fairly old, so we are now talking about something which was 7 years out there, and you can download it from here, and I also put a link in there. Just a couple of very small updates. So obviously, since 2011, we have not been sitting there twiddling our thumbs and not doing anything. Obviously, there were also some distractions in forms of from signals that were coming along. But one interesting aspect I want to mention here is Newtonian noise is not only coming from seismic fields, but there are recent studies carried out in Virgo, which actually seem to suggest that infrasound is actually something that we need to consider and which will limit the low frequency performance of interferometers at the surface. Again, the thing is that if you go further down, you're further away from the atmospheric fluctuations, and therefore you would win by going underground. So that's a recent paper which is on the archive down here. Good, I will swap some of all of these updates here, what has happened in the meantime. One other thing, just maybe I put two slides on here, just one other thing to mention. So far, we only talked about fundamental noise sources, okay? So coating noise, suspension thermal noise, and so on. In reality, 90% of the time, people at the observatories don't deal with these type of noise sources, but with questions, how do I lock my interferometer? How can I keep it stable? How can I control my alignment? How do I deal with facts? You know, when I switch on my lasers, suddenly I heat the optics expands, index of refraction changes, and so on, all of my mode matching changes. So there's quite a lot of work going on in dealing with technical issues, and one big one that I think someone here in the audience mentioned they work on is adaptive mode matching, where you have active elements where you know you have a knob actually to change the surface of a mirror or a lens in order to change your beam parameters and match them to a warm interferometer. One other aspect we haven't talked at all about, I'm not sure whether other lecturers will do, is calibration. Calibration is a surprisingly difficult business in gravitational wave detectors. Okay, we are very happy usually when we get to the level of, I think in O2 we were were calibrating to about 5% level. Okay, so you do a measurement where you talk about these strange numbers, 10⁻²⁰. Many, oh, Ellen corrects me. It's actually 3%. And then you do all of these $100 million dollar experiments and so on, and then you end up with a calibration of 3%. That sounds a bit strange. Oh, so why is that? The simple answer to all of this is, it's very hard. What you usually want to do a proper calibration is you want to inject a signal, a calibrated signal, into your interferometer and see how it propagates into your strain channel. So via the photodiode, all of the kind of servos and so on. And the problem is, how do you do this? Obviously, we can't create gravitational waves. It's very hard for you to somehow change space-time in a calibrated way between the two mirrors. So the only thing you can do is you can push your mirrors. But you need to push your mirrors by a tiny amount, because you have these crazy sensitivities of 10 to minus 22 in strain, or 10 to minus 19 meters. So you need to push them by something like 10 to minus 18, 10 to minus 70 meters. So by amounts of sub-atomic levels. And that's obviously fairly hard. And the real problem is, you would say, oh, why can't you do this and push it by a micrometer? Because first of all, you would lose all of your operation point. You wouldn't be on resonance anymore. But also, you need to think about linearities. There are very few systems which are really kind of linear to a sub percent or percent level over several orders of magnitude. Okay, so that's why calibration is very, very hard. And what we currently use as a standard calibration, because it's physically very easy, is just by pushing the mirrors around with modulated laser beams. So you just send photons onto your mirror, sinusoidally modulated, and if you have more power, you exert a little bit stronger force on there. In the next half wave, you have less power on there. And we use that because the physics is very easy. We know that the force is just P over C. Okay? Can't get much easier than having an equation with three symbols in there. So that's what we are currently doing. But again, there's something very surprising in there. It's very hard to calibrate the power of a laser. It's again something you can't be. A very interesting plot up here that Jeff Kissel actually dig out from a paper from 2010. So if you take a power meter, a device which can measure the power that's coming out of a laser, and send it to the national standard institutes like NIST or PTB or something like this, and then you you send one of these instruments to all of them, and then you take them back, and then you compare them, you get this amazing plot down here, okay? So these power measurements, what the standard institutes can do, varies by plus minus several percents, okay? And this is actually a measurement which is done, so I know for the PTB one, which is the one with the very small error bars, this is a heavily complicated measurement where they say, you know, you are allowed to use a laser of this wavelength, the beam profile needs to be this, the beam size needs to be this, the humidity in your lab is this, and the temperature, it's completely crazy. So calibration is something which is very, very, very tough right now, even though you don't believe it. And if anybody has some spare capacity, I think that's something that people would be very interested if you come up with some nice ideas. Here's a recent nice idea from actually done by LAP, just, I don't know, 50 kilometers from here, 100 kilometers in Annecy, where a very simple physics experiment is to actually use gravity to calibrate your test mass. And there, the interesting thing is that most of the parameters you can actually measure very, very accurately, and people believe you can get down to a factor of about 1%. Good, so calibration, technical noise is a big issue, but we haven't talked much about it. Just to give you an appetizer or get you curious about why these things are so much more complicated than one initially might think. Good. Finally, one quick question on costs, just again for the Einstein telescope, because that's something which will be important when we talk about Cosmic Explorer. What I took here is kind of the costs that we did in the 2011 ET design study, and I just made a very simple pie chart here. Don't need to look at the details, just have a look at this one here. If we want to construct the full site with six interferometers, three detectors, then the costs are roughly as following. You have 46% for digging all of the tunnels. You have about 40% for the vacuum. So 85% of your costs is driven by the vacuum and the tunnels. You know, all of the stuff you think is expensive, like lasers or mirrors or so, are close to peanuts, actually. It's 15% of the whole budget. Okay? Yeah. Oh, that depends very much on the local geology that you have. So that gives you, usually the key thing for going underground is to get rid of the Rayleigh waves. If you want to go rid of the Rayleigh waves, you need to go about 5 wavelengths of the Rayleigh waves down. So then depends on the speed of sound in your soil, whether you have soft soil or hard soil. But the calculations say that you need to go about 300, 400, 500 meters and you're fine. So that's a rough idea, but it very much depends on what your local geology is actually. And also I should say that this tunneling cost here has a delta of probably 2 or 3 sigma on there, depending on the soil and the rock conditions on where you actually do build. Okay, so that's a big uncertainty in there. Good. Anyway, so the expensive part is going underground, so you always need to think about for the Einstein telescope, is it worth it, or wouldn't it be much easier to cut all of this tunnel digging away and stay on the surface? Good, I switch over this stuff here. And then we should come to Cosmic Explorer, and in order to talk about Cosmic Explorer, we quickly need to talk about LIGO Voyager, which is a very, very neat idea. So if you look at the advanced LIGO sensitivity, that's the design sensitivity, which I had plotted here. And then what I did for this plot here is I came up with some, obviously you can argue again about factors 2 or so, some kind of facility limit, where the facility limit is given by assuming that you can only do a certain amount of Newtonian noise subtraction at the sites, and that you have some gas noise from the vacuum system. Then you end up roughly with this orange area here, where you say this is probably, we will not see any sensitivity better than the orange area from Henford or from Livingston. But still, there's quite a lot of space here, you would say, okay? Before we go to a new facility, there's some space for optimizing this. And this is what was started, I think, in 2012 or 2013. There was an interesting exercise where there actually 3 different teams formed, a red, a green, and a blue team. And then there was a little bit of a shootout, kind of a competition, who can design the best interferometer. And out of this, there was actually the LIGO Voyager design coming. And the LIGO Voyager design is more or less the same as for Cosmic Explorer. That's why I would like to dwell a little bit on it. And the key neat idea that you have in here is to say, yes, we built a cryogenic interferometer, but we are not going for the full benefit of getting the T down, but we are trying to only go down to 120 Kelvin. What do I gain by this? What is the neatness about this approach here? There are 2 things. First of all, and that was something that people already realized in the 1990s, you have a 0 crossing in the dL over dT in silicon at 123 Kelvin, I think, okay? So all your thermal noise terms, which have somehow a dL over dT in there, go away, okay? You still have the dN over dT, but the dL over dT, they go away. The other interesting thing you can do about this is that if you go for silicon at 120 Kelvin, the thermal conductivity is huge. It's nearly a factor 100 more than what you would have in normal silica, in glass, what we have right now. So all of these kind of thermal problems that I mentioned, you absorb a little bit of light, it heats your mirror locally, your dL over dT or dN over dT causes some disruption of your mirrors. So your mirror surface is deformed, you might have lensing and all of this kind of stuff. That more or less goes away because you have the high thermal conductivity and the temperature spreads evenly in the mirror. Okay, so that's the other interesting part. But the really, really neat part about this is how you actually can do the cooling, okay? So the idea about the, I should mention, the idea about the 120 Kelvin and the thermal gradients and the dL over dT being 0 is actually coming from Professor Kentaro Somiya at Tokyo. And then Rana Atikari from Caltech realized that if you stay at 120 Kelvin, all of your cooling gets much, much easier. Why is that? We talked about it in the morning. You have convection, radiation, and conduction. And we said conduction is the one only thing that works at very, very low temperatures. But here, if you have something where you just want to cool down to 120 Kelvin, and you make your heat shields even just liquid nitrogen temperature, not even liquid helium, you have 50 Kelvin, and the fourth power, Stefan Boltzmann law, and you can really, really extract a lot of heat out of this, okay? So the idea of LIGO Voyager is you can build a cryogenic interferometer where you don't need to do any cooling via the fibers, but you can do everything radiative, and you avoid all of the hard cryogenics because you don't need to go below the 77 Kelvin. Okay, that's something that Rana came up with, and that's a very, very neat idea. So that's LIGO Voyager. One aspect on this to think about is, and we mentioned this already a little bit earlier when we said, okay, if we go cryogenic, we will have to change the test mass material, we have to change the laser wavelengths and so on. So one thing to think about is if we say, okay, now we want to build LIGO Voyager, is how the design choices are compared, for example, to what we have been used to. So for example, I looked here at the some of the design choices when you go from initial LIGO to advanced LIGO. Okay, and many things that people were thinking about, what is the test mass material, what are the fiber geometry, do we go for non-degenerative recycling, all of these different aspects, and they were all individual aspects, okay? You could decide for this one yes, for this one no, for this one yes, for and they wouldn't have any influence on each other. The interesting thing now for this Voyager is, because you want to go for the cooling, you go to the different temperature, you need to go to the different material, you need to go through different wavelengths. So this is really kind of taking your vacuum chambers, emptying them once, and then do a complete reinstall, okay? So it's a slightly different thing. Anyway, I think it's worthwhile. Here is the sensitivity that you would get with LIGO Voyager if everything pans out as Rana and friends assume it will. You have here your advanced LIGO curve in cyan. You have in green the A-plus curve for proposals that were developed over the last year and are approved or submitted for an upgrade to advanced LIGO to be ready in 2023. And then you have here the Voyager curve, and you see you gain very much here at the low frequency end and the bucket, not as much as you would do if you go to 10 Kelvin, but this is something people, at least some people, think you can realize in the LIGO infrastructures. Good. So then the next thing is that for the third generation, people started to think about, okay, ET went from a few kilometers to 10 kilometers. Where's the limit? You know, why? I think it happened on a conference, actually, after a few beers, that some people were saying, okay, what's the limit? Why don't we go for a factor 10 and go from 4 kilometer to 40 kilometer? And again, it's a very nice and neat idea, because as we mentioned before, all of your displacement noises, you know, if you have the same coating noise, if you have the same suspension thermal noise, and so on and so on, if you just make your interferometer longer, if you think about it, that your strain sensitivity is your delta L over L, all of your displacement noises stay the same, you divide by something which is 10 times larger, so your strain sensitivity goes down by a factor 10. And actually, for some of the noise sources, it's even better. Because, for example, for the coating thermal noise, because your laser beams are diverging faster, you can make your laser beams bigger and therefore even win by more than proportional with the lengths. At some point, this actually becomes a problem, because your laser beams will get so large that you might not be able to buy mirrors anymore. But what you can achieve is quite an impressive sensitivity. So this is the Cosmic Explorer. There's a pessimistic and an optimistic. I personally would still call both of them very optimistic. But you see here the sensitivity improvement from a LIGO to Cosmic Explorer is amazing. I mean, we're talking here about factors of nearly 100, around 100 hertz or so. And this is mainly due to the scaling, but as I said, also you see your coating noise is somewhere down here, and advanced LIGO is currently up here, so you reduced it by immense factors, partly through the cooling, partly through larger beams, and partly through to this length effect, okay? And this one here is now a detector which doesn't require to be built on underground. You still have your gradient noise here, but also there you have won, obviously, by a factor of 10 already. Maybe you can do some subtraction. And for the Cosmic Explorer, people currently consider a surface location. So would you be able to get rid of all of this tunneling cost that we have in ET? Unfortunately not. Earth's curvature on 40 kilometers actually becomes significant. So here is a drawing. What you would have if you have 40 kilometers, then somewhere in the center of your tubes, you would need to dig some trenches of 12 meters, and then at the end here, you would need to put in some hills of something like 21 meters. So it's still quite a lot of earth movement, but still it will be much, much cheaper than actually going underground. One key component here is, as I said, the divergence of the laser actually sets a limit. If you want to have a laser beam going for 40 kilometers and still being able to catch all of the light to send it back to build up Fabry Perot and so on, for this Cosmic Explorer design, you will need to have mirrors of the order of 1 meter. And that's a tough business. We are currently at 37 centimeters, so scaling that up is quite a bit. And again, the key thing here is to think about the technology of that, the metrology of that, but also still the weight of its mirror on these kind of scales will actually deform slightly. Interesting question. Have people actually thought how flat our mirrors actually are? If you think about it, these mirrors, it's quite amazing. So usually we have 35 centimeters, and the flatness of the mirrors over the 35 centimeters is of the order less than a nanometer. Okay, so you have something with a scale of, let's say, 10 centimeters would be 10 to minus 1 meters. You have a flatness to 10 to minus 9 meters, so it's a ratio of dimension or area or length versus heights of 10 to minus 8. So how can you imagine what that actually means? You can do it, think about the Earth, okay? Take the Earth diameter or equator or whatever, which is about 10 to the 5 kilometers, 10 to the 4 kilometers, actually. 10 to the 4 kilometers, which gives you 10 to the 7 meters, okay? So if you think about it, that means if you would take the Earth as your reference and make it the Earth as flat as a mirror, then it would mean that, for example, Mont Blanc would be of the order of 10 centimeters or something like this, okay? So that's the flatness of these mirrors, and this is quite a big step to actually transferring this technology from the 30 centimeters to what we have in mind for ET, which is 45, 50, 60 centimeters, to actually going for something like a meter here, okay? So why do people in the US actually consider a 40 kilometer detector? And again, that comes to population density and just having a very big country with some very flat areas. So what Matt Evans, or actually I think it was Evan Hall, did was to take a topographical map of the US and then look for areas which are flat enough so that with acceptable digging costs, you could actually place a 40 kilometer L shape. And here you see near Salt Lake City, each of these black lines is actually one of these L's. So there would be quite a few locations in the US where you could actually have the space for these 40 kilometers. In Europe, it's probably not very realistic to do this, okay? So what would we get from third generation detectors like Cosmic Explorer or the Einstein Telescope? Not sure, someone asked a question this morning. How far can we actually see the redshifts of these systems? And this is what you see here, total mass of your binary system versus the redshift. And you see we go to very odd numbers here, that's of 100 and so on. So you can see actually fairly far out. You would get, because of the much better sensitivity in the bucket, you get a higher sensitivity of Cosmic Explorer here. With ET, due to the low frequency sensitivity, you would see a bit better the high frequency part. Good, I skip over this. And then the last thing, just to think about, people are also asking, you know, what are the timescales? And I'm afraid I'm not going to engage in that game because, you know, you lose right from the beginning, okay? There's no chance. And many clever people, like here, that was actually Lisa and Mike, you know, have shown how to do this. You present a slide and there's a time error and there's no marks, you know, what is where. And then you're on the winning side. But the idea is more or less, I mean, if you want to go through an instrument, you always need to start actually doing your simulations, coming up with the concepts. You do some tabletop prototype experiments to learn them. You do the proper design, and then you have the installation, commissioning, and so on. So this is what we have. We are currently here in advanced LIGO. We are close to getting the full design, A+. We have more or less done most of the design, the technical design. I think we need to do the conceptual design. There are some technical designs to be done, but that will be installed, as I said, here somewhere as 2023. And then Voyager will come in the second half, or if it comes, will come in the second half of the next decade. And then Cosmic Explorer and ET have slightly different timescales. ET is currently envisaged to get funding, or it would be nice to get funding in around 2025. I think for Cosmic Explorer, it's a little bit later because you can't just ask for the same money for Voyager and for Cosmic Explorer at the same time. So you need to do these subsequently. But that's a rough idea of what's going to happen. Good. With that, I would actually like to stop with the third generation and talk a little bit about kind of the idea of the workshop. But I take questions if anybody has anything super urgent right now about third generation. Yeah? Yeah, very good question. So the question is, how good can ET do sky localization if you just have ET on its own? Is that the question? So I think at the moment people are hoping that you would get at least two of these, so that you would have, whether they call, I guess we won't see in just ET, we won't see just the Cosmic Explorer, we might see some muddle up between the two, and then the hope is that you would have two of these supported by the advanced plus detectors. But there's currently, and we'll come to that in a second, there's currently quite some work going on. The Gravitational Wave International Committee has started some exercises about 1.5 years ago to better understand what is really needed for the third generation. There are several committees working on this, there is one on the science case side which actually looks at the network capabilities and what we would need for certain sources. And that's something we'll come to actually in a second. Oh, that's, yeah, no, that's not a good word.
Well, there's a reason why they use it. And I, the reason why they use it is because you can get so sensitive that you would basically detect every binary black hole in the universe, because beyond a certain distance, there aren't any.
Yeah.
What do you think?
I would be interested in the 99 other different astrophysical objects that you want to see, like, you know, non-galactic supernovas or whatever. I think there's more than just black holes. I mean, at the moment we are very much focused on them, but I don't think that's that's any reason. Okay, and I think whatever it has this kind of a claim of absolutism, like the ultimate, is not very good. I don't like this. It closes the door for what comes afterwards, or and you never know. You might want to have this, depending on your age and, you know, your vision. Good. I didn't realize that was still off there. So I think in principle, the ultimate, I think, is off the table right now. Good. Okay, so what I thought is, what we can do is a little bit of a workshop activity where, as I said, I came in with a thought of, let's say, you know, everybody designs their own 3G detector using Bench, but realizing that very few people are doing experimental work in here, but many people are very capable in astrophysics aspects, I thought we can split this a little bit. If some people still want to design their third generation detector, perfect, but maybe others are more interested in either optimizing a gravitational wave detector for their source that they are currently working on or interested in, what their PhD project or the postdoc project is about, or you can think about, for example, helping shedding light on this aspects of, at the moment, what this GWIC 3G committee is looking at, you know, the performance of ET versus Cosmic Explorer. Is it actually worthwhile spending all this money to go underground for getting the sensitivity between 10 and 2 hertz, where there's also a big question mark whether we actually get all of our technical noise sources out of the way. So is this a reasonable risk to take or not? Or, coming back to the question that Alan had, what would we need in terms of a 3G network to do your science? So if you are interested in, we had this earlier today, a non-GR signals which have some non-GR characteristics, what would we actually need? Do we need 5 detectors? Do we need 3 detectors? How do they need to be located? What's about stochastic backgrounds, if you want to see them? You know, what's the optimal distance between interferometers? So there are so many different aspects where I think it would be very nice if every one of you, or at least a few people who seed then groups, can somehow find a way to engage your PhD project or your postdoc project to and find a connection to the third generation detectors. Because, I mean, that's what I hope all of you will still be around in 5 years and 10 years. So that's what actually going to happen and what you where you leave your mark in the future. So see this as a kind of, you know, start thinking about this right now. And I can leave this here later on up with a few more ideas of a little bit more details on these sources. But before we do this, let me give you a very quick tutorial for how GWINC actually works. So if you want to design your own interferometer, I hope you all found on this webpage, what's going on here, the link to the software. As I said, it's a software that is in development for 20 years right now. So actually it has reached a certain maturity and it's actually very useful. Okay, it's not useful for making a technical design of your interferometer, but it gives you a feeling for what do I need to push, you know, how heavy do I need to make my mirrors, what light powers do I need to take in order to get an optimal sensitivity. Good, so let's take 10-15 minutes to go through how this actually works. Okay, check, have some people looked at this stuff? And some. Okay, so you have, I show you the MATLAB one because I'm a bit better with the MATLAB stuff. So if you open this, you have a bunch of functions here. Most of these functions are actually there to calculate certain properties of your interferometer and individual noise sources, okay? So for example, and most of these have intuitive names, like for example, graph G is gravity gradient noise, or you have somewhere here, get coating Brownian noise and so on, or gas noise and so on. So these are individual functions which are usually kind of invoked or queried by the main GWINC file. And this is the main GWINC file. If you look at this, it has the following structure. So yeah, give in GWINC and the arguments are a low frequency and a high frequency cutoff. So this is the frequency range you are interested in for your interferometer. Then you have an IFO in. IFO in is kind of, you know, it defines what your interferometer looks like. So tells you I have this and this arms of this and this length, this and this laser, and so on. And then you have two more parameters here, objects in here. One is actually a file in order to evaluate, to benchmark your sensitivity for the standard. We'll see an output in a second for some standard cost functions like the binary neutron star range, or for stochastics, what actually values you can get, and so on. And then you have here one field for a few more options. So how do we run this? There's actually an example in this file here. If you look at the README file, you get an example here. And it's actually fairly simple. You just define the frequencies, you define the name of your interferometer model, you run this, and then you will get back some noise, and you will get back some scores. So why don't we do this for a second, just to see how that works. So if you run this, then you get this following output here in your field. So you get at the beginning some parameters about your interferometer, what is the power in your interferometer, what are certain detunings, what is the arm power. So that's kind of all the stuff that experimentalists are interested in. And then at the end, you get the astrophysical scores, you get a binary neutron star range, a horizon. So this is kind of the average, how far can you see. The horizon tells you what is the most distant one you can see. And obviously, there are some details here in there. So if you look at the documentation, it will tell you what are actually the masses of the binary neutron stars, what is your definition of how high is the SNR that you can still see it, and stuff like that. So I think, for example, here it's 1.4 neutron stars, and the SNR is 8, I think, is the cutoff, and so on. It also gives you the stochastic omega that you can reach, and then some information about binary black holes. And again, you need to look up what are the ranges here. Okay, and then in addition, you get, you get a sensitivity curve out. How do I make this smaller? And then you get this typical advanced LIGO sensitivity curve. That is what is currently in the repository as the IFO model. And you see here a curve which hopefully doesn't look so much different from what I had shown you before. You have your quantum noise, you have your coating noise, and so on. Good, so that's the output. Let's have a quick look at how the GWING file actually works. So we said what the input parameters are. The key is that you actually get further down here a list where all of these different calculations are done. So not don't need to worry about this. There are some optical parameters. And then in the end, you get cases here where you calculate all of the different noise sources. Where is that? Where are we here? Sorry. So you calculate the different noise sources later on here. So this is what you get for the different thermal noises, Newtonian noise sources. So each of these are queried one after another, all of your different noise sources. Then you just get them here into your function. And then it's as simple, because this is all in power spectral densities, you just add them up to get your final score. And then you do some plotting and some evaluation. Okay, so in principle, you could go in there. And let's say if you say you want to write your own function for calculating, for example, gravity gradient noise, then you would just plug in here your own function and could leave all of the rest the same, for example. Okay. Finally, the IFO model, what is all in there? That is actually partly overwhelming, but that's why I think it's so easy to start from advanced LIGO and just instead of starting from zero, you have something that you know is valid and you can make certain changes. So you have here certain parameters, and most of these are self-explaining, but they also have some, at least some units. Often they have a proper reference there. So for example, ifo.infrastructure.length is 4 kilometers, fairly self-explaining. You have some residual gas pressure or polarizability. These are things that, you know, have taken us 10, 20 years to learn how they work. So I would probably not play with them. But for example, you can make your interferometer longer. And then you can see how this all goes down. What you have down here, you have the laser wavelengths, you have your power. You can do things to your optical configuration. You can do things to your suspension, change the mass of the mirror, and so on. Okay, so that's more or less what this program offers you to do. Yeah, then you're on your own, because I've not used that version, unfortunately. I would guess so. I haven't looked at this as Python stuff. It's just under development, but I was told, you know, people feel happy to release it right now, so that's why it's on the skit there. But I personally haven't looked at this. I can give you some emails of the people who have done this part. But otherwise, my recommendation would be to use MATLAB, okay? But as I said, I mean, if we come back to the plan of what the workshop session would be, I think that thinking about that many people in the room are not currently building interferometers and are probably mainly not having the plans to do this in the near-term future, you know, an interesting aspect, for example, would be, okay, to leave GWING aside and rather go for having a look at, you know, for your personal source, what search you're doing, or you'd maybe develop template banks for compact systems, what will be the difference in your terms between ET and the Cosmic Explorer, for example, due to the cutoff frequency? how much more templates would you need, how much more computational expensive is all of this kind of stuff, and so on. Or go and think about these networks. What I have done so that you don't need Gwink at all is if you go to the web page where I put the materials, why is that so slow here? The materials, you will find ASCII files of the standard Cosmic Explorer curve and the standard ET curve. So in principle, you can just have a look at these two files here and see for your astrophysical source, what can you do with these sensitivities? Okay, so that would be another example of what one can do. If you don't have access to MATLAB on your laptop, and if the Python doesn't work for you out. Good. So that's more or less all I wanted to say. I will leave this one here up for people to think about. So this is a bit more detail on localization, calibration, low frequency cutoff, and so on for third generations. Important aspects, and the key thing here is really all of these questions. It's not that I give you a problem sheet here with worked examples or so, but all of these questions are real questions that people at MIT, Caltech, Golem, AI are currently thinking about. So that's why I think it's actually interesting for you to spend some time today, tomorrow, to think about them and see whether some of the stuff you're anyway doing in your PhD is actually useful for that. It's an experiment, you know, it might go completely wrong and we don't get anything out there, but let's be brave. Good. So it's now another half hour. So I would suggest the following in terms of timings. We have another half hour where people can think about it and discuss what kind of groups might form. Again, I put onto the web page a link to a Google spreadsheet where people who have some ideas can actually put their names and so on, and then people can, you know, form groups. I will stay in the lobby for another half hour to, or maybe even here, so that if people have some idea and want to discuss, you know, how you can make this useful, what aspect would be interesting, we can discuss this. And I would say I do the same tomorrow between lunch and whenever the afternoon session starts, so that people can come and talk. And I'm pretty sure that many of the other lecturers will also be happy to help with that. I know that Nelson said he would be happy to do this. He's currently not here because of a Virgo, important Virgo telecon, but for example, tomorrow he would be happy to help with that. Okay. Thank you.